Good day from Washington, D.C., and I'd like to extend a warm welcome and a Happy New Year from the Africa Center to all of our alumni, colleagues, and partners from over 50 countries we have registered for today's webinar, The Gender Dimensions of African Peace Operations. My name is Nate Allen, and I am Assistant Professor of Security Studies at the Africa Center. I'm the Africa Center's faculty lead on peace operations. And before we continue with today's program, it is my honor to turn things over to the Africa Center's interim director, Dan Hampton, to say a few words as we kick off this first program of the year. Dan, over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Allen. Well, a warm welcome to everyone who joined us. Good afternoon or good morning, depending on where you're at as you connect. First, I want to say thank you for taking the time to connect and be part of this important webinar this morning. We appreciate it, and I'm sure that you'll get a lot out of it with our panel of experts in our discussion today. And Happy New Year to everyone. We're glad to be back here at the Africa Center in this new calendar year and excited about what 2022 holds. As Dr. Allen mentioned, my name is Daniel Hampton, and I'm the Deputy Director here at the Africa Center. I know we have many alumni, our family and friends from the Africa Center connected today. And if you're wondering why I am doing the introduction rather than Ms. Kate Omquist-Knopf, if you are not aware, Kate left the Africa Center after 7.5 years of outstanding and exemplary service. Her tour had come to an end, and she's moving on to bigger, better, greater things. She's still very much involved with the African security issues, and I'm sure she'll stay connected to many of you, our family and friends from the Africa Center. They're still in the process of selecting and trying to find a new director for the center. And for our alumni friends, we'll keep you updated and inform you through our alumni communications once that decision's been made and we have new leadership in the helm. So again, thanks so much for joining us. For those who aren't familiar with the Africa Center, or just a reminder about what we do, we were established by our Congress for the specific purpose of studying security issues relating to Africa and serving as a forum for research, communication, and exchange of ideas. That is our mandate. And how do we achieve that mandate? Our mission is to advance Africa's security by 1, expanding understanding, 2, providing a trusted platform for dialogue, 3, building enduring partnerships, and 3, catalyzing strategic solutions. And how we advance that mission statement is through 3 pillars, or at least we describe 3 pillars. First is our academic affairs and our programs and our events. Events similar to what we're doing this morning with this webinar on such an important topic as gender dimensions of peace support operations in Africa. We also have our research and strategic communications section. And I hope all of you have been to our website many times. If not, I encourage you to go there. We have all our published materials and publications posted there, free to download in PDF in French and English. And we run spotlight pieces on trends and security issues on the continent, and just a wealth of resources on our website. So please go to our website frequently and use it as a resource. And then our last pillar is our engagement with you, our family, our friends, our alumni. It's our outreach. It's staying connected to our audience. And that's done through our community and alumni affairs section. So please, that's a two-way street. We want to stay in contact with you. We want you to contact us. We want to keep that relationship and make it strong and make it stronger. So you are part of our family. Thanks for joining us today. And we look forward to having you be part of our larger network. Now, before I turn it back to Dr. Allen, just let me say, I'm excited about this webinar we're doing this morning. There's a lot of discussion about the aspects of gender and security in the African environment, and particularly the gender dimensions of peace support operations in Africa are at the forefront of that. And I think Africa has been leading the way in this issue globally. I know a lot of progress has been made in the United Nations in this front. And really the missions that have occurred in Africa, either through the African Union or the UN, they've really set the standard and started this model for the gender dimensions of peace support operations. So again, I'm very excited about this webinar we have today and the work that Dr. Allen and the other panelists and the staff have put into it. So thank you once again for taking your time to join us. We appreciate it very much. Dr. Allen, back to you.
Thank you there very much, Dan, for that really excellent introduction of the Africa Center and to this program as well. I'd like to ask our panelists, if they have not already, to please turn on their videos and let's begin today's webinar. The peace operations community has long been at the forefront of efforts to promote gender mainstreaming, equality, and sensitivity in armed conflict. Over 20 years ago, the landmark Security Council Resolution 1325 on women, peace, and security was passed. And it still to this day undergirds global efforts to address the gender dimensions of armed conflict. As defined in that report, these efforts have generally proceeded along the four pillars. We can call them the four P's. First, efforts to increase female participation at all levels in efforts to manage armed conflict. Second, to prevent conflict and reduce civilian harm by promoting women's rights. Third, to protect against sexual and gender-based violence. And fourth, to recognize different gender-based priorities and differences in conflict resolution. That's female participation, preventing conflict by reducing civilian harm through protecting women's rights, protecting against gender-based violence, and recognizing different gender-based priorities, the four P's. Today, we are taking stock of these efforts to advance the WPS agenda in African peacekeeping operations. To what extent have these four pillars been implemented? What are the key obstacles and barriers? And what more needs to be done to improve gender sensitivity and mainstreaming? Is the current peace and security architecture enough, or do we need more ambitious reform? To help us unpack these important questions, it is my honor to introduce two leading practitioners, each of whom in their own way is at the forefront of efforts to improve gender equality in African peace operations. You should have access to their biographies, so I will keep my introductions relatively brief. First, we have General Birame Diop. He is military advisor to the Secretary General in the Department of Peace Operations at the United Nations. General Diop has over 30 years of military experience, previously serving as the Chief of Defense Staff of the Senegalese Armed Forces and National Security Advisor to the President of Senegal. We are very fortunate to have General Diop as a regular facilitator, panelist, and if you go back far enough, over 20 years, I believe note taker with us here at the Africa Center. And we are greatly looking forward to his contributions today. Next, we have Major Steplyne Nyaboga. Major Nyaboga is a Kenyan peacekeeper who served in the recently ended United Nations African Union hybrid mission in Darfur, known as UNAMID, as a gender and child protection officer. She was deployed to Zelenge in central Darfur state from February 2019 through 2021, where she worked to address the gender dynamics of regional engagement, military engagement, and conflict in that region. For her efforts, she received the 2020 United Nations Military Gender Advocate of the Year Award, a very distinguished honor. We are absolutely delighted to have two such distinguished panelists with us today. And we're going to start with you, General Diop, to speak to some of the gender dimensions of African peace operations at the strategic and policy level, and then go to Major Nyaboga to talk about some of her personal experiences at the tactical and operational level. So to begin with, General Diop, I'd like to get a sense first for our audience of what the major ongoing gender-related efforts being undertaken by peace operations in Africa are. What are the main commitments made by the UN and perhaps the AU, specifically with respect to gender mainstreaming and peace operations? And do you think, just briefly, whether that these commitments are sufficient?
Thank you very much for your introduction and for your kind words. Let me first of all join you in wishing all the participants a happy new year, 2022, and also take advantage of the opportunities that is given to me to thank ACSS. I have been working with for more than 20 years. And as you rightly said, as a note taker first in 1999, and later on as facilitator and as guest speaker in several occasions. I would like also to take advantage of this opportunity to thank all the participants. If I understand well, they're coming from more than 50 countries, meaning that we have a good representation of the participant. And just make a wish, which is to do our best to make this session more interactive than having an authoritative presentation, because we want to share what we are doing at the UN level, but we would like also to listen to our participants so that we can feed the substance we have at the UN and improve the work we are doing. And as you rightly said, I concur with you. I will rather focus on the strategic and policy commitments and let the major focus on the tactical aspect of the subject. The UN has done a lot of work in promoting gender, women participation in peacekeeping. I will say straightforward that we are very happy about what we have achieved so far, but we are aware of the fact that it is not at all sufficient, and it will never be sufficient given the delicacy of the subject and the complexity of the subject matter and the challenges we will be always facing while working on this very difficult topic. But we are very satisfied with what we are doing, and we will keep making the necessary efforts to keep delivering. The first commitment we have made at the UN level, as you know, is related to Women, Peace and Security Initiative, which aims at promoting a full, equal, and meaningful participation of women in peace processes, in political solutions at all levels. So these priorities are taken into consideration in our Action for Peace Plus. Action for Peace Plus, which is an implementation strategy for Action for Peace. And Action for Peace is the roadmap of what we are doing in all regards. So all the priorities of Women, Peace and Security Initiative are taken into consideration in the seven pillars of the Action for Peace Plus. Be it in the collective coherence behind political strategy we are trying to put in place, be it in the capabilities and mindsets we are trying to put in place and promote, be it in the strategic communication we try to undertake, or be it in the strategic and operational integration we try to make happen, and also be it in the accountability to peacekeepers we assume, the accountability of peacekeepers we are trying to hold accountable peacekeepers in their doings, in their discipline, in their conduct, in all these seven pillars, and even in the efforts we make to establish a good cooperation with the host nation. So in all these seven pillars of Action for Peace Plus, we try to integrate the priorities of women, peace, and security. In addition to that, it is important to mention the policy for gender-responsive peacekeeping also. The call of the Secretary General to action for women, transforming peace and security. All these initiatives, all these commitments are extremely important for the integration of women in our peacekeeping operations. But in addition to these initiatives, we are on a regular basis working very closely with the TCCs, the troop contributing countries, and the police contributing countries, so that we sensitize them, we educate them on gender, peace, and security issues. And we do it through their permanent missions here in New York and their permanent representatives. We also work directly with our missions to make sure that they have the gender expertise. They have the data available to them. And they also have the analysis we have made of the work we are doing on gender issues so that they can mainstream gender in their policies and their strategies. And finally, the office I am in charge of, as you know, or as you may know, the Office of Military Affairs is the manufacturer of the missions. And while manufacturing our missions, we make sure that at all stages of the manufacturing, we integrate the gender dimension. When we are doing the assessment, we integrate gender dimension. When we are planning, we integrate gender dimension. When we generate forces, we integrate gender dimension. When we define our policies and our doctrines, we also integrate gender dimension. And even when we evaluate our performance, we take into consideration the gender dimension. These are the things I would like to share with you as major commitment we have at the UN for the moment. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, General Diop. I think your remarks made very clear how complex and difficult gender issues are, and therefore how demanding they are, that they need to not just be a niche topic, but in fact, integrated into basically every aspect of peace operations and peacekeeping policy. And it's good to see high-level leaders acknowledge that and begin moving in that direction. Perhaps the biggest focus area over the past two decades has been to significantly increase female representation among contracted military staff and troop contingents in UN peacekeeping operations. And there really has been some notable progress, with a recent estimate suggesting that women make up about 7% of uniformed peacekeepers, up from 1%, I think, about three decades ago. Nevertheless, these estimates suggest that gender parity in uniform services is a good ways off, perhaps 30 years or more. And I'd like to know, from your perspective, both as UN military advisor, as well as based on your experience of Chief of Defense Staff in Senegal, how can gender parity in African peace operations be achieved? Is it possible for international and regional peacekeepers to fully integrate women into African peace operations without more progress at the national level?
Without progress at the national level, it can be very, very difficult for any given TCC or PCC. TCC standing for Troop Contributing Countries. We like the acronyms in the UN. And PCC as a police contributing country, to have a meaningful representation of female in the units that are deployed. It's very difficult. Even though I think that we can do it the other way around. If any given country has decided to focus on having a good representation of female personnel in the deployed unit for peacekeeping, these deployed female personnel, when they come back, can have a positive impact in what is going on at the national level. Yeah, but I think the best case scenario would be to start home first, make progress, and then naturally, we will also make progress when we deploy our units for peacekeeping operations. As a chief of defense staff, even before, because I am a strong believer in the fact that when we are mixed, we are always better. But when we are mixed in the right conditions, that's a prerequisite. You need to make sure that you create the good environment, the harmonious environment that allow men and women to be together without any discrimination. If you have this environment, you create the conditions for a better collective intelligence. We are smarter and we are more capable. So I'm a strong believer of the fact that our future will depend on how well we will it's a human right issue, because we should be in all sectors give the same opportunities to both men and women for them to do whatever they want, to support the societies they belong to support the country they serve, to support the military they serve. And to me, at the operational level, if we want to deliver, we need to have men and women equally represented. So this is my personal, and I'm very passionate about that. So even before being a CDS, I tried my best at the positions I was to promote this gender parity. By doing what? By sensitizing people. Remember, we have in the military a community that is extremely conservative, whereby mindsets and culture and practices evolve in a very difficult manner because people are very conservative. It's a masculine community. And having mindset and culture evolve is extremely challenging. So you can do it gradually by sensitizing people. So we have to sensitize. We also have to undertake advocacy, because concomitantly to the sensitization, you need to take swift and bold decisions to accompany the sensitization. And it's the decision-making community that has to take these decisions. So advocacy, to convince those who have the responsibility to take decisions, to be convinced that decisions have to be taken. You also need to have a project by defining, developing a national gender mainstreaming strategy or policy, whereby you target your goals, you say your goals, and you also set your timeline and identify the resources you need to make sure that your project becomes a reality. So you need a project, sensitize, advocacy, and project. And beyond this project, you need also to come up with a relevant, realistic, and comprehensive training model with training modules. With this set at the national level, you can be successful. And when you're successful, you're attractive. And when you're attractive, you have a higher level of representation of women. And if you are successful back home, you have created the conditions of success outside your boundaries, meaning in the peacekeeping operation. Now, internationally, and particularly in the UN, we have the same responsibility to keep sensitizing our TCCs, who are our strategy partners, so that they are convinced that they have a role to play and play effectively this role. We need also to make sure that we develop policies and strategies. And in this regard, I will just mention one extremely important policy or strategy we have, which is the Uniform Gender Parity Strategy that sets the goals for the representation of female personnel in our missions. The target is 2028. For IUPs, individual uniformed personnel, we target to have a representation by 2028 of 25%. The goal for 2021 was 18%. And thank God we were able to achieve this goal. We have 18%, sometimes more, in our IUPs composed of women. We are very proud of that. We celebrated it. And it's more challenging now for the contingent and the units. Therefore, we are less ambitious or more realistic for the units. We are targeting for 2028, 15%. And normally for 2021, our goal was to have 8%. Unfortunately, we are lagging behind. We have only 5.6. So we need to do our homework and make sure that we absorb this gap as soon as possible. We, and I will finish with this one, are working in close collaboration with our Canadian friends, to make sure that the LC initiative, which is a very well-known initiative, is successful, is implemented in the best conditions possible, so that we have a better representation of female, so we have a good training program in all countries that are involved in this very important initiative, so that the resources that are necessary to accompany, because it costs money also to mainstream gender. It requires training. It's a science you need to master, and it's not given. You have to know what are the techniques, the tactics, what are the constraints, the specificities, the sexual specificities, so that you are skilled enough whenever you take a decision to take into consideration the sexual specificities of women and the sexual specificities of men. And you have this binary approach of things. It's not easy. Even in our families, we are not able to have this binary approach when we are taking decisions that can impact our sons or our girls. And I will keep it there. I hope I was able to give you some elements that can constitute the response of you.
Oh, thank you, General Diop. I think that was very comprehensive. And I think you also laid out a very compelling reason for national militaries across Africa to take seriously the recruitment, retention, and promotion of women. It makes you more operationally effective. And there is now empirical evidence that indicates that. So I'd like to, you know, while enhancing female participation in peace operations is essential, it's far from the only important gender-related issue in peace operations. There are also ongoing efforts by peacekeeping missions across Africa to address sexual violence, as well as to prevent conflict through gender-sensitive community outreach. And I'd like you briefly to talk about, in your view, what kind of progress there has been in these efforts to address gender-based violence and conduct community outreach, and what are the key challenges?
Thank you very much. I will be very brief on this issue. Just highlight the fact that we have a zero tolerance policy on this. Zero policy tolerance. And I will not mention any country given the sensitivity of this topic, but recently we had to take a very painful decision to stop our collaboration with one given TCC because of allegations related to sexual violence. The reason is that we cannot accept as a UN to deploy to appease people's lives, to support people in their efforts to come back to normal life and add to their sufferings. We cannot afford that. We deploy to help people minimize their sufferings, not to add to their suffering. Particularly when we deploy next to populations that are lacking of almost everything, that are very vulnerable, and we take advantage of their vulnerability to have them do things they would never do if they were not in these situations. So we have a very strong policy on this. But having the policy is important, but also sensitizing, educating TCCs so that upstream, they take the necessary measures to prevent the occurrence of these kind of wrongdoings is better. So we work very closely with TCCs to make sure that they are aware of the risk their troops will face when they deployed. And while they deployed, we also make sure that the mission works on a daily basis with the deployed troops to prevent the occurrence of these kind of things. And the UN has a very dedicated service called CDS, Conduct and Discipline Service, which is in New York. They are doing a wonderful job in sensitizing and educating. And in all missions, they have their representatives, we call CDT, Conduct and Discipline Teams, that work in close hands with the mission leadership, but also with TCCs. And our aim now is to invest more in educating populations, the vulnerable populations, using the paramount leaders, the local community medias, so that they are aware of the fact that their young populations should be behaving and being aware of the fact that they are at risk since they are cohabitating with military people or police people or even civilian peacekeepers. They are at risk for these vulnerable populations, very young, to be engaged in very wrongdoings so that the parents, the communities can prevent those kind of things. I will also mention the very well-known Resolution 1325 that was voted in 2000. It is a very important resolution that tries to prevent sexual violence, conflict-related sexual violence in conflict zones. This is also a very important resolution I should mention. And there is a policy also on conflict related sexual violence. There's a handbook that help TCCs to get ready and prepare themselves on these issues. And when we organize our advisory and assessment visit, we also take advantage of these visits to empower our TCCs. When we organize PDVs, pre-deployment visits, we also take advantage of these visits to empower our TCCs. So those are the measures so far we are trying to implement. And very soon, there is a guideline our department will be publishing to also support TCCs in the sensitization of their people on these very delicate issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, General Diop, for that very comprehensive outline. We look forward to reading that guidance to troop contributing countries on gender and sexual-based violence. Now we'll turn to you, Major Nyaboga. You were recognized for your work encouraging gender-sensitive outreach to local communities in Darfur. And before we get to that, I'd first like to discuss your experiences more broadly as a female peacekeeper. You recently served distinction at UNAMID, and from your perspective, what were the main challenges you faced as a female peacekeeper? And briefly, what do you think can be done to improve some gender sensitivity at the operational and tactical level in African peace operations? Some of the kinds of things that General Diop was talking about, he was trying to do at the policy and strategy level.
Female peacekeepers play a very significant role in peacekeeping missions. And in relation to Security Council 1325, which calls for more female peacekeepers in peacekeeping operations, when you go to mission areas, you can see a very important role that they play. For example, they have improved accessibility to the local community. When I was talking to the fellow military peacekeepers, after conducting the various outreach activities, they could attest to the fact that when the male peacekeepers were going by themselves to conduct those activities, you could get that the response was low, especially when they were interacting with the community women. But when they incorporated the female peacekeepers, there was that environment that was conducive and they could get more information from the local community. Another thing that female peacekeepers have contributed to is they are role models. At one time, we conducted an outreach program. It was a workshop on a sensitization workshop on sexual and gender-based violence. I did a presentation on the role of military in prevention and response to sexual and gender-based violence. And after that particular workshop, one of the young ladies came to me and he told me that when I grow up, I want to be like you. And from that, I could get that I had played a role in motivating this particular young lady. So in relation to some of those significant contributions by female military peacekeepers, we do face some challenges. Some I may have experienced personally and some were from the fellow peacekeepers that I interacted with. One of the challenges is the problem of limitation in facilities, in particular accommodation. I used to do outreach programs and sometimes I could go train the contingents at the team site level, so which meant that I had to stay with them for a few days before coming back to the force headquarters. So there's this particular time I went to a team site and I was allocated some accommodation. So the accommodation was not self-contained. So, and the toilets were like 600 meters from where the accommodation was and you had to navigate through other accommodations. So this was the situation. It was at night, I need to go to the washrooms and they are quite far and it was raining. So that was really a challenge to me. And I imagine that other female peacekeepers experienced the same, those who were in that particular team site. The other challenge is allocation of duties. Some of the time, when we were looking at the reports on the patrols that had been conducted, most of the patrols in the beginning had only males going for the activities. So when I was interacting with the female peacekeepers in those particular, from those particular team sites, when I went to them and trying to find out why they were not participating, they were like, no, we are being given assistive roles in the camps because the others deem that it's not so safe to go out there. You see, you have an asset. And this asset is female peacekeepers who are supposed to go out there to go and get more access to the women and gather more information, and you are not utilizing them. So that was like a limitation, and it was a challenge, because now you'd get reports, you'll get under-reporting, that is, and this could affect majorly on decision-making. The other challenge was when giving even these duties within the camp, some duties were not allocated to the women. And I based it on the aspect that they were stereotypes, that females cannot handle certain jobs. And for example, when I went to instruct or to train some contingents, at first, it was on gender basic concepts. At first, the class was not so receptive. So, and as we went by, they began to open up to whatever I was teaching them, and you could see their response, and now they began to appreciate my work. And at the end of it, I got one particular peacekeeper who came to me, and he was like, "Madam, you see, at first we thought about what you came to talk to us about, and you were like, no, is this lady really up to the task? But at the end of the session, we've come to realize that it was very important information to us, and we've gotten a lot of information from you." So, and looking at these challenges and other challenges such as welfare programs that are not, or policies that are not conducive to females, you get that in some contingents.
I think we may have lost Major Nyaboga. Her connection might have gotten cut. So I think what I'm going to do is, while we wait for her to hopefully rejoin us, I'm going to ask General Diop one last question, then hopefully she'll join us. If not, we will go to questions. General Diop, I'd like you to end on what are some positive examples? You've talked a lot about all the great initiatives that are going on at the UN level, at the policy level, in the Department of Peacekeeping Operations to implement gender mainstreaming and sensitivity policies. What are examples of current UN or AU-sponsored missions where, in your view, gender equality efforts have been implemented well? And what are some of the broader lessons learned about how African peace operations can protect citizen security by addressing gender issues?
Thank you very much. I was really expecting the major to share some successful experiences that have taken place on this issue. I hope that she will return to us and overcome the technical issues she's facing now. But I can share one experience we are very often talking about, which is the role the women's network have played in the successful organization of the electoral processes that took place in MINUSCA in 2021 in Central African Republic. Women networks have played a key role in the success of the elections. And thanks to the involvement of MINUSCA with this women network. So concretely in MINUSCA, the same also took place in South Sudan, where UNMISS, our mission there, has successfully worked with grassroots networks of women to make progress in the reconciliation, both locally and nationally. And even currently in Mali, the same also is taking place. The MINUSMA is working with many, many grassroots women organizations to impact positively the security and also the peace at the local level and at the national level. So those are really concrete examples we want to duplicate anywhere in our missions we can share with you. MINUSCA, a concrete one, South Sudan and MINUSMA.
Thank you very, very much. So unfortunately, I don't think Major Nyaboga has rejoined us yet. So I'm just going to start going through some of our questions in hopes that, Major Nyaboga will join us. And I'd actually like to start, because we haven't spoken much French, I'd like to start with a French-speaking question first.
I would like to know if in practice the women are receptive with regards to what is expected to them in these peace-maintaining operations. I think that the question means, what is the motivation of the women? Are they engaged enough to join peacekeeping operations? Because normally there are men who are involved in politics and strategy. Well, if I understand this question well, I think that our colleague who asked this question would like to have more details also about the role of the woman. It's important that the woman is on the forefront. The woman needs to know what we expect. And I think that we should not here fall into a tendency where we take decisions, where we think that we are taking the right decisions for the women. There is nobody who is better positioned than the woman to answer questions and to define her own role. So I think that we should step back. I think that we should be a little bit more humble, we, the men, when we deal with questions linked to women, because women have their tools and they are totally well positioned to explain to us what they want, how they want it, and what are the circumstances they would like to see. I think that this is an excellent question. Women are at the center of what is happening around them. And I think, you know, that if the person who says that everything is done only through me, for the people around me, that is not correct, because the person for whom you want to do something needs to have an input. And especially the women with their intelligence, the intelligence level is definitely the same between women and men. And the woman is best positioned to work for themselves, for men, for the children. And it is very important that the woman needs to be here at the epicenter to take their own decisions. The woman needs to be convinced. And the woman needs to have the freedom, whether they would like to join or not. We have to talk to the women. We have to also make our organizations more attractive to women so that they would like to join us. This is what I'd like to say. Thank you so much. It is very important that women are attracted to the organizations. There is another question. And this question is, what do the women do when they join the forces?
What do women do after serving in peacekeeping missions once they've been deployed? What kinds of work do these gender units do? Does their work in peace operations at all help them implement gender-sensitive training in their security forces at home?
What the women are doing, I think, unfortunately, the gentleman is frozen. When the women get back to their home country, they have lots of more experience, new experience. They have more expertise. And this expertise can be used in structures where they might be employed later on. It is true. These women can support other women who follow them in their footsteps so that these women have better tools at their hands and that they can play a better role in the structures where they work. I don't think that there's a difference between the role of the woman and the role of the man. If women who were in peacekeeping missions, if they, those women come back home, they come with a new experience, with new perspectives, new opinions, because they were accompanying troops of different countries with a different culture, with a different expertise. And this interaction between the different units, this helps. This strengthens the women. And the interaction between the women of one country and the women of the other country, this facilitates sharing of experiences. And when these women and men go back to their home country, they will have a positive impact, or they could have a positive impact on their own nation. This is something which is very important. And we think that it's something we have to organize, the return on this positive feedback. Often we don't do that. We have a debriefing where the people tell you what they learned when they were deployed. But I think that what they learned needs to be the basis of a new plan, of a new program, which then will positively impact their own country. And here we need to improve, because we need to organize this feedback, not only on a national level, but also on a sub-regional level. Because in the same region, we have lots of countries who deploy troops to other countries. And if they all come back home with new lessons, isn't it possible to have a framework in place so that we can share these lessons, and this could strengthen everybody? And we do not have that yet. And I think that we need to put efforts into such a platform.
Thank you very much, General Diop. I noticed that we actually have Major Nyaboga with us among the attendees. Could we please get her promoted so we can have her continue with her presentation? Please continue with your remarks. I'd just like you to maybe to incorporate some of what you're saying. You were talking about your challenges as a female peacekeeper. And if you could also just add, because we're running a little bit low on time now, a little bit about kind of your work, the impact that it had, and how it reflected some of the mission objectives, that would be wonderful. And sorry we're having all these technical issues.
Yeah, sorry about that also. So I was deployed as the first gender advisor and at the same time as the child protection focal point. And part of my work was advisory. I provided advice on how to integrate gender perspectives in the military activities, that is to the first commander and all the other commanders. I also did capacity building through training and awareness creation through outreach programs. I coordinated with the other components, that is the civilian component and the police component, on matters to do with gender. And apart from that, I also did monitoring and reporting on issues to do with gender. So during my tenure, I managed to sensitize 95% of the troops in, that is the military components, on gender. I conducted trainings. At first I did with the staff officers in the mission training center. Then I went to the team site level with the aid of the gender focal points to train the troops. So the other achievement was that reporting was 100% gender sensitive. Through the reporting, we could see how the team sites were handling issues, and the sensitivity level was 100%. It was gender disaggregated data that they provided. Then in terms of outreach to the community, the patrols, at least 50% of daily patrols were gender sensitive. That is, the females were included in the patrols. And this was facilitated also through collaboration with the civilian components and also the police components in team sites where we couldn't have enough female military peacekeepers. So the challenges that we experienced, one was a language barrier during the outreach programs. Some countries were French speakers amongst the peacekeepers. That is, some of the peacekeepers were English speakers, and the environment we are in was an Arabic-speaking country. So we had to have a language translator or interpreter. And at the time when the mission was closing, that meant that the personnel had been downsized. So what we did to address this problem was to utilize, amongst the contingents you could find, there were troops that could understand Arabic language. So we used them in order to get information from the community, in order to get a lot of access from the community. The other thing is use of art. Art meaning, when we were conducting these awareness programs, such as campaigns on sexual and gender-based violence, we could incorporate dramas, plays, and in that way, though there is the aspect of language barrier, they could get what the theme of the campaign was about. The other challenge that we experienced during the outreach was mobilization, especially when the target groups were women. And in an environment whereby the women were playing the role of being caregivers, at the same time, they had to attend to these outreach activities, it created somehow a conflict. So we had to come up with like incentives. For example, we had to come up with quick impact projects, like we could teach them skills on how to go about their livelihoods, and this will at least attract numbers. And also during the COVID period, we'd give out promotional material, and some of it was protective gears, for example, the giving out of masks and sanitizers. That was in collaboration with the civilian component. And since our military, we didn't have the funds to get those materials. So we relied largely on our on the civilian component. And that there was the importance of good working relationships with the civilian component. Then the other challenge was COVID-19. COVID-19 impacted a lot on the outreach activities. So most of the patrols were now reduced. So it was more of providing a protective environment for the local people. As you know, there was lockdown during that period. So even getting information, correct information, so as to tackle issues affecting the community was an issue. And that is why we utilized things like mobile communication, which was not, of course, with everyone. So there was limited communication with the community. So basically, those are the challenges that we experienced.
Thank you very, very much. So briefly, what are the lessons that you might want to point to for other peacekeepers working in other contexts to better enable to conduct gender-sensitive outreach to local communities? Then we'll wrap up with some Q&A.
One of the recommendations is that the commander should be involved in all the activities. They should be at the forefront in promoting gender, integration of gender perspectives. When you have the goodwill of the commander, when you have his support, then you're likely to succeed, because the subjects, that is the soldiers, mainly rely on him. So if you have that support, then you're likely going to succeed in the peacekeeping mission. The other thing is that the importance of partnership, collaboration with the components. Each of the components should work together to a common objective of achieving the mandate of the mission. So without that togetherness, that oneness, that partnership, then you're not bound to succeed. Another one is understanding the environment in which you're working in. If you get, you have a clear understanding of the people, the community that you're working in, then you'll be able to know their strengths, their weaknesses, the areas whereby you're supposed to give more assistance or support. And that will play a key role in ensuring your mission or your operation is successful.
Thank you very, very much. Really appreciate those points of advice. So I'm going to wrap up. We're running low on time. We have far too many questions, unfortunately, that I think any one of you can answer. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to wrap up with three or four questions and then give each of you the opportunity to address any one of them that you might like. So one question we have is, is the question of gender perceived in the same way by different member states, right? And how do you address different perceptions of gender by different states or different communities? Major Nyaboga, you talked a little bit about this in your work already. Another question that we had, sort of a comment in the chat that I think I'd like both of you to address, right, is this idea that gender begins and ends at women's participation. I think if you look at, for example, UNSCR, it's actually much broader than that, talking not just about female participation, but gender-based violence, about addressing how the different ways in which violence impacts men and women. So if you both could address the question of whether or not we should just equate gender with women, or whether it's a broader concept and there are both ways in which gender impacts men and women, I think we need to speak to that. And then finally, we have a question on, relatedly, are there model men or male champions of gender drain streaming that we need in order to move things forward in this area? And let's I think, since we're running low on time, if we'll start with you, Major Nyaboga, then we'll go to General Diop, and I think then we'll have to conclude. So any thoughts on those questions?
I think on the issue of gender, that it should be more about women. No, that should not be the case. It should be like a partnership between the men and the women. Both should be the stakeholders in addressing matters gender. When we were conducting outreaches, and at some point we were talking to females, that is at the community level, and it was one of the senior leaders who was addressing them, wanted to know what their issues are and how the mission could support them. We found out that some men were like sticking nearby, trying to peep and see what was going on, and they were curious. And you see, and in some instances also, you could find that when the women go back to their families after maybe a workshop in which the men are not integrated or are not part of, it would raise a lot of family issues. So when everyone owns up the issue of gender, that is both male and female, then in that way, we'd be together. We'd be handling the matters together.
Thank you very much. General Diop.
Yes, building up on what the Major said, I would say that the gender is a broader concept. We tend to assimilate gender to women, which is a mistake. But I understand why we have this tendency. It's because women are considered as being lagging behind in many aspects. They have to catch up. So we have been engaged in a very positive discrimination, affirmative action these last decades, to a point that we're giving the impression that when we talk about gender, we mean only women. No, but gender is about men and women. the interaction, the environment they share. When you talk about gender, you have in mind the sexual specificities, both men sexual specificities and women sexual specificities. When you talk about gender, you are thinking of gender equity. So men or women should not be suffering from impartiality or discrimination just because he is a man or she is a woman. So when you talk about gender, you are also thinking of gender equality, meaning that men and women should be given the same opportunities, the same political rights, the same economic rights, the same social rights. So you create the conditions for them to be equal, not similar, but equal. So I think gender is broader than just women. And now gender, there is no one fits all perception of gender. Depending on where you are, the way you perceive this gender issue is different. Because there could be a religious connotation. There could be a cultural connotation. That's what makes it very delicate. That's what I said in my opening remarks. It's very delicate, very complex, but not impossible to work on this. We just need to make sure that we are humble enough to not consider that what we perceive when we talk about gender is what everyone should perceive. We need to be open to our differences. Avoid to be too judgmental, but rather be in a listening mode and try to understand the other's culture. Try to understand the other's differences so that we can live together, because the differences make our togetherness extremely challenging. But in the meantime, it is our strength. If we are able to create an environment whereby everybody, regardless his religion, his race, regardless his culture, can fulfill his dreams, we are in a better world. Now, men's champion, I think this is a very good idea. Yeah, and the fact that we are every time nominating a woman as a gender champion sends the wrong message, because we give the impression that it's only about women, but they are men who are very, very well invested, very well committed in participating in promoting gender in their communities, in their institutions, and these men should also be recognized. One mistake we are very often doing, Nate, but it is understandable. We are focusing so much on women that sometimes we frustrate some men. Sometimes we are very discriminatory vis-a-vis some men. So we should also be balanced. We should be balanced. Women, yes, deserve affirmative action, but in the meantime, we should not forget about our men friends also. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And with that, so I'd like to thank both of our panelists and our alumni for a really excellent panel. Lots of deep insight here, lots of engagement, lots of questions. There are two main themes that stood out to me that I'd like to footstop on before we conclude today. First, even as we celebrate remarkable progress, I think it's pretty clear from what we heard from both Major Nyaboga about some of the tactical level challenges and operational challenges she faces, even, for example, in getting access to a bathroom, you know, as well as from General Diop, that the fight for women's participation and gender equality in peace operations across Africa has really only just begun. It's great to see this issue receive such high level attention. It's great to see significant progress in enhancing women's participation in civilians, police, and peacekeepers over the past 20 years. But I think as both of us have made clear, as our comments today have made clear, this is a generational task, and having equality and participation is really just the beginning. You know, we have to think more about, you know, how gender impacts each one of us, both men and women, about different and throughout peace operations, throughout armed conflict. And we have to recognize that women are, or people, I think, who have different perspectives on gender, perspectives on gender that are not, you know, stereotypically masculine or feminine, still face immense challenges in getting their voices heard and in getting their needs addressed. And, you know, second, I hope that we all recognize that gender sensitivity and mainstreaming is not just a women's issue or only for gender advisors, but is really something that all of us, and especially men, to build on General Diop's last point, working on peace operations across the continent must take into account. And it's not a soft security issue. It's a hard one, backed by increasing empirical evidence. We know now that militaries that get gender right, that have greater gender equality, greater female participation, we know they're more operationally effective. We know that all male or mixed gender units can reduce civilian harm and provide tactical benefits that all male units cannot. And whether it's because of the actual presence of women or whether it's because we're performing gender roles, who knows? But I think that's really, really important evidence. And we must recognize that armed conflict can neither be effectively prosecuted nor peacefully resolved without addressing its gender dimensions. And despite all the progress, despite all the attention, I think it's clear that peacekeepers across Africa still have a lot more work to do. And this is not going to be the last conversation we have on the topic. So many thanks again, General Diop, Major Nyaboga, for your participation, for your remarks. Many thanks to our audience for their attention and their participation. I wish you all a warm evening, warm greetings for the new year, and look forward to continuing the conversation soon.